Now let us see what is a hinged column. So if you take the case of a hinged column, we can see that the load P is applied axially and the column has undergone a buckling like this. At a location of X from the O, you can see that there is a deflection of Y here and the total length of the column is L. Now we are supposed to derive the equation for the buckling load. For that, first we have to take the moment about the X. So I will consider this point as X. And if I take the moment about X, it is going to be P into Y. So P is this load, and the distance from point X to the line of action of P is Y. So the moment is P into Y, and the sign is to be negative based upon the sign convention that we have discussed in the previous session. The sign has to be minus P into Y. So here we have to discuss about the deflection equation, which is nothing but the M is equal to EI into D square Y by DX square. This will come in the deflection of beams. So this is an equation which relates moment, Young's modulus, moment of inertia and the deflection Y. Right now we have written the expression for moment based upon the deflection. This Y is the deflection from the axis. So now we can equate these two and we can say that this is equal to minus P into Y. And if we rewrite, we can write it as M equal to EI into D square Y by DX square equal to minus P. So if we bring everything to the left hand side, we can rewrite like this. D square Y by DX square, EI is here, plus P into Y equal to 0. And if we divide by EI, the equation is going to reduce to D square Y by DX square plus P by EI into Y equal to 0. So this is the general expression for the hinged beam. So this is just purely a mathematical expression. Now, what are we supposed to do here? See, we have to understand a bit of ordinary differential equation where this is of the form D square Y by DX square plus M square Y equal to 0. And the solution for this particular equation is defined as Y is equal to C1 cos MX plus C2 sin MX. So this is the equation for this type of differential equation. And if we compare the equation, the general expression, mathematical expression, with the one which we have obtained for the hinged column, we can say that under the place of M, we have M square, we have P by EI, and M is nothing but root of P by EI. So based upon this particular solution, if we write down the actual solution of our hinged column, it is going to be like C1 cos root of P by EI into X plus C2 sin root of P by EI into X. So this is the general expression that we have, solution that we have obtained for the hinged column. Now the question is, how can we relate this particular solution to a column? In order to do that, we have to give some boundary conditions. So boundary conditions are the basic parameters, basic elements that is going to link our solution to our problem. So this is purely a mathematical relation. It can be applied anywhere, but if you want to apply this particular mathematical expression to this particular hinged column, you are supposed to give the boundary condition for. So boundary condition means end condition. What is the condition at its ends? So if we look here, this is a hinged position where the deflection is 0. So at this location, x is equal to 0 and y is equal to 0. And at this location, at x is equal to L, again you have y is equal to 0. So these are the two boundary conditions we are supposed to use to find out the constants C1 and C2. Once we use these boundary conditions to find the value of C1 and C2, we have an expression related to your hinged column. That is the basic principle, that is the basic nature where we use a mathematical expression and converting it into the actual engineering problems. So let us apply the boundary conditions. First, let us apply the boundary condition at x is equal to 0, y is equal to 0. So the value is going to be what? When y is equal to 0, then c1 into cos 0 plus c2 into sin 0, which gives the value of c1 equal to 0. Because sin 0 is 0, cos 0 is 1, so obviously c1 is equal to 0. So we have obtained the first constant, value of first constant as 0. Now let us apply the second boundary condition. Like, what is second boundary condition? At x is equal to L, y is equal to 0. Again, y is equal to 0. So if you apply here, it is going to be 0 equal to, c1 is already 0, so there is no need to write the first term. Second term is c2 sine root of p by ei into L equal to 0. This is what we have. We are left with. Now let us have an analysis of this. So right now we have 0 equal to c2 sine root of p by ei into L. Now the question is, either c2 has to be 0 or sine has to be 0. Anyway, c2 cannot be equal to 0. Why? If c2 is equal to 0, that means your expression is completely vanished. There is no expression for solution for y. Y is equal to c1 has already obtained as 0. Now, if again c2 becomes 0, that means you don't have an expression or solution for y. Right? That means c2 cannot be equal to 0. C2 cannot be equal to 0. If c2 becomes 0, that means y is equal to 0. That is not a possible solution. So definitely c2 cannot be equal to 0. Now, the only possible condition is that the sign can take a 0 value. So when we get a 0 value for sine, so sine 0 is 0, sine 180 is 0 and sine 360 is 0. So this is pi. So we can say that at this particular location, the value is going to be 0. So we can say that when p by ei into n equal to pi, this expression is going to become 0. Because even if we give 0, then again the meaning is going to be same. We are not going to get any kind of useful equation. So, if we use sine equal to pi, there also the value is going to be 0. If we equate this, we can say that pi equal to p by root of ei into L. And if we square this up, we can say that pi square is equal to L square into p by ei, where p is the crippling law, right? So, if we cross multiply this, we can say that p is equal to pi square ei by L square. So, this is the expression for the crippling law for a hinged condition. So we know that P is the axial law. So this is the law that can create a buckling in the hinged column. So this is called as the limiting law for the hinged column, where L is the length of the column, E is the Young's modulus of the column, and I is the moment of inertia of the column. Anyway, I have to say that it is not just simply the moment of inertia, it is the least moment of inertia. That's a very important point you have to keep in your mind. It's least value. Least MI that we have to use, which I will explain later. For the time being, you consider that I is equal to the least moment of inertia, and this is the expression for the buckling load for the hinged column. So kindly go through this derivation once again, and this is the same format. Same methodology that we are going to follow for the other type of columns. So in short, how you have to follow? First you have to write down the expression for the bending, then you have to equate it with the ei into d square y by dx square, then you have to write down the solution for that like this. So this is the second part, so this is going to be the third part, and the fourth part is the application of boundary conditions. And the fifth part is arriving at the equation for the buckling load. So this format or this procedure, these steps are going to be repeated in different end condition. The only thing that is going to, there are two changes that we can expect here. One is the equation of moment is going to change, the solution is going to change, and finally the boundary condition is going to change. But this procedure will be followed for the other type of end condition. So we will discuss about a derivation for hinge or fixed free in the next class. And right now, we focus on this derivation. Thank you.